operated devices that move the stops in the console. Similar mechanism exists up in that chamber such that when the keys are played, which pipes of sound is controlled by another electromagnetic device known as a relay and switch stack. It's up there. It's original 1928 technology. So what you hear when Mark plays is going through that original system using leather and valves and brass rods and contacts of all sorts. A good 1,100 wires come in, a good 900 wires go out, and it's all low voltage, low power, 1 watt per electromagnet, but there's a whole lot inside of those chests. Steve, if you want to add anything about the organ, then turn it over to Mark.
Okay, I just want to talk a bit about this wonderful instrument here. This is a theater organ, and its relative is the classical organ, which has been around since the Middle Ages. And this was, theater organ was invented in the early 1900s by a gentleman named Robert Hope Jones. He was a brilliant inventor, but a lousy businessman. And he went bankrupt, and Wurlitzer took over his invention. And so popularized this instrument. It found a lot of use accompanying silent pictures. Silent pictures were never actually silent. There was always music. First it was a piano, and then there's a lot of competition with different movie houses to see who could be bigger and better. And so the idea was that one talented person playing an instrument like this could replace an entire orchestra. So there's another name for this instrument is a unit orchestra. And so these found homes in a lot of theaters back in the 20s. And Wurlitzer was one of the biggest ones. And this instrument has been here ever since 1927, original installation. And it's been here all these years. Wurlitzer actually had a showroom next door in what's called the Wurlitzer Building. It still has signage on the front that says Wurlitzer. And this instrument is related to the classical organ, but they made a lot of changes, Hope Jones did, to make this more suitable to accompany pictures, silent pictures. Among things that they added that you won't find on a classical instrument were the toy counter. So it has various special effects.
Car horn as it would have been in 1926.
Section, you have the flute and piccolo. These are carried over from the classical. All these instruments are carried over from the classical. And then we have a special pipe specific to this instrument called the tibia. Combined with a tremolo, which you also can find in classical instruments, it gives a very lush, beautiful sound. Speakers on this instrument, and no first albums out of this, there's like hundreds of pipes, tune pipes up in the pipe chambers, right and left, that produce the sound. And a lot of maintenance goes into keeping this going. It's sort of like a 1,000-person telephone exchange, thanks to John Kerber there. John Kerber and Arthur Moore are two other members of the crew here. We maintain this organ for the Orpheum. And anyway, this instrument fell into disrepair around the 40s. It was used a lot in the vaudeville days. It never actually was used to accompany silent pictures because it came in right at the end of the silent picture era. So it was used for vaudeville shows, and then sort of fell into disuse. This has a lot of leather parts, and leather deteriorates over about 30 years, its lifespan. A lot of leather pouches activate the pipes. And so by the 40s and 50s, it was pretty much non-functional. And a group of volunteers got together. I wanted to get it going for national convention back in the 80s, and they completed it, and we've been maintaining it ever since. So it's used now for like LA Conservancy events, so I hope you all are going to see the last remaining seats. I'm sure it's going to be used for the one that's the show is going to be here. Anybody have any questions?
Yeah, what about the